How you doing, Goofy?
This office was used for appointments for special guests who came to visit the studio. And although Walt did not play the piano himself, the studio songwriters would often stop by to perform the latest Disney melodies. For instance, Leopold Stokowski played many selected pieces from Fantasia more than 50 years ago on this baby grand piano. And in the 1960s, the Sherman Brothers introduced their award-winning score for Mary Poppins, including one of Walt's favorite songs, Feed the Birds. Now over on the back corner wall, you see portraits of Walt's two daughters. That's Sharon on the left and Diane on the right. These sketches were done by a close family friend, Norman Rockwell. And then finally, right below them is a very small portion of Walt's extensive collection of miniatures, which was one of his greatest fascinations. Now in just a moment down here at the end of our lobby, up on the gray screen, we'll be showing a short film tracing the history of Disney animation from the animated cartoons up to the full-size audio animatronic figures that you see at Disneyland today. This will be about a 6-minute film, and directly following that, we'll be moving over to our main theater to see great moments with Mr. Lincoln. Thank you.
From the very beginning of his career as a young artist in Kansas City in the early 1920s, Walt Disney was excited about animation, about bringing a new kind of life to the motion picture screen. And he was always looking for that intangible, something new.
They attached the cartoon working with the humans. The cartoon would always come off the drawing board and run around in the real room and work with a real person. I said, well, maybe I'll pull a reverse one and I'll put the humans in with the cartoon.
Walt Disney startled the world in 1928 with Steamboat Willie, the first cartoon with sound. Mickey Mouse was born, and Walt Disney was on his way to revolutionizing the animated film.
Well, I made you an experimenter, so with the success
Mickey Mouse, Donald Duck, Goofy, Pluto, and a whole array of famous Disney personalities were soon stars of the silver screen. Now Walt could reach out into still another new dimension for his art of animation, the feature-length cartoon.
One of the, no doubt about the personality, so I sort of picked the name to fit the personality. So I had Dopey, he was Dopey. I had Happy, he was Happy. I had Bashful, he was Bashful. We had a big premiere, the Carthy Circle Theater, big, great Hollywood premiere. All the Hollywood brass turned out for a cartoon.
Many more great films followed as Walt Disney and his staff moved on to new developments in the art of animation. Perhaps the most unique was the combining of cartoon characters with live actors on the screen, as seen in the classic Mary Poppins. During all his years as a filmmaker, Walt Disney continued to search for new ways to express his art of animation. And finally, in the late 40s and throughout the 1950s, as Disneyland was being planned and built, he created a revolutionary new form of entertainment he called audio animatronics. This was literally three-dimensional animation.
I understand what happens in controlling these birds by these extraordinary instruments. You can at the same time record their movements on tape.
That's right. After we get a program, it's like rehearsing a show. And you go through it, reverse it, and you finally say, that's it. We say, all right, let's go for a tape. Then we go for a tape. All the things we do here are recorded. And then when we play the tape back, he will do everything he's doing here. Or it's all part of a program show.
And I understand then that the next step beyond the birds has been to do the same kind of programming with human beings.
Yes, with human beings, yeah.
The idea that most excited Walt Disney was to create a new kind of show about America's presidents, and especially about America's 16th president, Abraham Lincoln.
Ever since I was a small boy, I know I had a great personal admiration for Abraham Lincoln. So when we decided to recreate some of the great moments in Mr. Lincoln's life at the World's Fair, we directed all our energies to that task. We wanted to bring to the people today the inspiring words of the man who held this nation together during its moment of greatest crisis, the Civil War. Now, to recreate a truly lifelike image of Lincoln, we use our new medium of audio animatronics. To start with, we were fortunate to being able to secure this life mask of the 16th president. How do we get this blank?
This is actually a copy of an original life mask by the sculptor Leonard Bull in Chicago in 1860.
Before Lincoln was president. Before he had a beard.
That's right.
Now with this to start with, our sculptor Lane Gibson has been able to create this very accurate likeness of this great man. During our exhaustive research into Lincoln's life, we studied his mannerisms, his gestures, and even his voice characteristics to create a faithful likeness of this honored man. The final result is so lifelike that your lifeline is hard to believe.
Unbelievable and inspiring were some of the words fairgoers used to describe this new portrayal of Lincoln. With this in mind, Walt Disney gave Great Moments with Mr. Lincoln a permanent home here at Disneyland. But Disney designers continued to improve the art of audio animatronics. In 1984, they met with scientists from the University of Utah's Center for Biomedical Design. A stunning new advancement was developed, creating incredibly lifelike movements. Tomorrow's technology, married with the sensitivity of today's Disney artisans, allow us to stand once again in the presence of a man whose spirit guided the nation through a time of turmoil, whose words inspired generations to follow. We invite you now to step into our theater to experience a few great moments with Mr. Lincoln.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be starting our presentation of Mr. Lincoln in just a moment. If I could have you step over this way. The doors here on my left will be opening toward you automatically in just a moment. Once inside the theater, we do record that there be no smoking, refreshments, or flash photography. Our show is about 16 minutes in length, and please make sure you look down and watch your step as you enter.
Right next to Mr. President.
Are you sure we can sit down?
Oh, I'm sorry.
First they were written, proclaimed to the world an idea new among men. This was the American dream, the prayer for the future. But that golden goal was not to be had without cost. The American way was not gained in a day. It was born in adversity, forged out of conflict, perfected and proven only after long experience and trial. Our nation's greatest crisis occurred when Abraham Lincoln was our president and our protector. For Abraham Lincoln gave all to save the Union.
My countrymen. Speedily pass away, with malice toward none, with charity for all.
Spirit is with us still, for he is one with us, and we are one with him. We pay tribute here not to a man who lived a century ago, but to an individual who lives today in the hearts of all freedom-loving people. His prophetic words are as valid for our time as they were for his. And now, the skills of the sculptor and the talents of the artist will let us relive great moments with Mr. Lincoln.
People just now are much in want of one. We all declare for liberty, but in using the same word, we do not all mean the same thing. What constitutes the bulwark of our liberty and independence? It is not our frowning battlements, our bristling seacoasts. These are not our reliance against tyranny. reliance is in the love of liberty, which God has planted in our bosom. Our defense is in the preservation of the spirit which prizes liberty as the heritage of all men, in all land, everywhere. Destroy this spirit, and you have planted the seeds of despotism around your own door. At what point shall we expect the approach of danger? By what means shall we fortify against it? Shall we expect some transatlantic military giant to step the ocean and crush us at a blow? No. All the armies of Europe, Asia, and Africa combined could not by force take a drink from the Ohio or make a track on the Blue Ridge in a trial of 1,000 years. At what point, then, is the approach of danger to be expected? I answer that if it ever reaches, it must spring from amongst us. It cannot come from abroad. If destruction be our lot, we ourselves must be the author and finisher. As a nation of free men, we must live through all time, or die by suicide. Neither let us be slandered from our duty by false accusations against us, or frightened from it by menaces of destruction to the government, nor of dungeons to ourselves. Let us have faith that right makes right. And in that faith, let us to the end dare to do our duty as we understand it.